I did want to continue this theme of the glory of God in the gospel and take a look at it from the perspective of a theme that we find in the scripture, particularly in the book of Joshua. It runs throughout the entire scriptures, but it does indeed develop for us this whole idea of the glory of God in the gospel, the good news. Joshua chapter 1, verses 1 to 9. Listen as I read. After the death of Moses, servant of the Lord said to Joshua, son of Nun, Moses' aide, Moses, my servant, is dead. Now then, you and all these people get ready to cross the Jordan River into the land I am about to give to them, to the Israelites. I will give you every place where you set your foot as I promised Moses. Your territory will extend from the desert to Lebanon, from the great river, the Euphrates, and all the Hittite country, to the great sea on the west. No one, see that in verse 5? No one will be able to stand up against you all the days of your life. What an incredible promise. As I was with Moses, so I will be with you. I will never leave you nor forsake you. Be strong and courageous, because you will lead these people to inherit the land I swore to their forefathers to give them. Be strong and very courageous. Be careful to obey all the law my servant Moses gave you. Do not turn from it to the right or to the left, that you may be successful wherever you go. Do not let this book of the law depart from your mouth. Meditate on it day and night, so that you'll be careful to do everything written in it. Then you will be prosperous and successful. Have not I commanded you? Be strong and courageous. Be not terrified. Do not be dismayed, for the Lord your God will be with you wherever you go. I mean, could you imagine hearing those words uttered to you when you're receiving probably the greatest, most challenging, most terrifying assignment ever, to lead a nation into a promised land and to do battle with the land inhabitants? And so we see the divine warrior theme here in the book of Joshua. Joshua chapter 1, verses 1 to 9, the book of Joshua is a war story. I love war stories. It's about land. It's about leadership, law, and victory over the land inhabitants. These opening verses that we just read really do introduce us to these themes and the vital role of God in each of them. The vital role of God in land and leadership and law and victory over the land inhabitants. The divine caller enables servants for leadership. God, who is calling Joshua to lead, is going to equip him and enable him for this leadership role. The divine giver promises to give Israel a dwelling place. I will give you this land. The divine warrior supernaturally defeats the land inhabitants. The divine king calls his servants to faithful obedience. The book of Joshua is a critical piece of Israelite history. And these themes just are loud and are significant and are encouraging and are challenging to us as we live out our lives as New Testament believers. The book of Joshua establishes the faithfulness of God to His covenant promises. You know, day after day, as you walk this campus and as you move in and out of classrooms, we are trying to affirm to you in a clear, affirming, convincing way that God is faithful to His Word. I mean, that's part of our worldview. God is faithful to His Word. And you can bank on it. And so that was how God began with Joshua as they planned to enter into the promised land. It also accurately recounts the struggle of the nation to believe and occupy the land. I mean, the people of Israel struggled to believe God and to take His promises and embrace them and enjoy them as they moved into the land. Just like you struggle and I struggle, just like your faith is low and weak and sometimes very faint in its existence. They struggled, we struggle. But the Word of God is sure. The Word of God is firm. It also anticipates the future work of God regarding Israel, the land, the kingdom, the new creation. And it's filled with good news. Joshua is a good news kind of book that affirms the faithfulness of God, the reliability of His Word, the ever-presence of God with His people as they work through the challenges and the gifts that He has laid out for them. So we need to hear the gospel message of Joshua as New Testament believers. You know, we need to understand that there is good news in this book that you and I can benefit from today. It's not an older testament that is old and useless. It was given before the New Testament, but its message definitely resonates with us today. We believe that there is a gospel message in Joshua because of several key texts of Scripture. And you might imagine what some of them are. 2 Timothy chapter 3, verses 16 to 17. What is the nature of the Word of God? It's given by inspiration. It's useful. It is the inspired Word of God. There is use, benefit, advantage to the Old Testament Scriptures. Look at Romans 15:4. The Old Testament Scriptures teach us how to have hope. Also, 1 Corinthians 10, verse 6, we are reminded that the Old Testament is an example to keep us from setting our hearts on evil things. As you read the storyline of the Old Testament narratives, you are reminded, listen, don't do this. This is what's going to get you in trouble. Stay away from this. And so there is a warning that comes to us very personally, very intimately, and an encouragement as well. And then, of course, Luke chapter 24, verses 25 to 49 tell us that these Old Testament texts point us to Christ. And it's Christ who explains to us how the Old Testament points to Himself. So the big idea of this text that we want to look at this morning is simply this. The divine warrior fights for, but notice this, and against his people in order to accomplish his eternal purposes in their life. Now let's play that out as we look at this text here this morning. My goal is this, severalfold. I want you to know who the divine warrior is and what he does. I love just telling you and preaching often about the greatness of God. I just love that topic. I just love to tell you how great our God is and help you find your hope and your confidence in the greatness of God. I mean, I don't think I could have a better job than to do that, just to keep telling you our God is great and see what He does, see how He does it, and see what He's calling us to do. But when you look at this, Revelation chapter 17, verse 14 is an interesting text because it says there, "These will make war with the Lamb. The Lamb will overcome them, for He's the Lord of lords, the King of kings, and those who are with Him are called, chosen, and faithful." I want you to know who the divine warrior is. We're going to see that indeed it is the triune God. It is Jesus Christ in particular. And I want you to see that when you come to the end of the Revelation in chapter 17, look how all of these themes come together. You have a redemption theme. These will make war with the Lamb. You have a military theme, and the Lamb will overcome them. The sacrificed Lamb will overcome them. I want to be in His army. You see, I want to be part of that army. I want to be a soldier in that troop, knowing that my King, my Lamb who will be slain, is the one who will overcome. And then it knows also, for He's the Lord of lords and King of kings. And those who are with Him are called, chosen, and faithful. Do you see the royal theme there? You've got redemption. You've got military. You've got royalty, emphasized right there in Revelation chapter 17, verse 14. I want you to believe that the divine warrior is still on active duty. You know, when we think about what we're doing here, I want you to believe that the divine warrior is still on active duty. The divine warrior who went before Joshua and all the Israelites to lead them into the land is still on active duty today. He's on active duty leading you through the ups and downs, the challenges of your life. And I want you to see that this morning. I also want you to be willing to repent. You know, perhaps we don't hear enough about repentance. The Puritans often referred to themselves as repenters. And I think there needs to be a deep sense in our lives that as we see the greatness of God, we're continually humbled, more willing to repent, less resistant to embrace or to touch. We want to stay away from sin and unrighteousness and ungodliness. We need to be a community of worshipers, or known as a community of repenters. And what is repentance? Simply turning from sin and its darkness and its kingdom and its warfare, and turning to the divine warrior, turning to the Lord God. And I want us to be called, in a sense, to repentance as we look through the text. I want you to give up the fight in your life against the rule of the divine warrior. We don't like to be submissive people. We want to be in charge. We want to be in control of all the details. We want to reign and rule over the details and the routine of our life. And God is calling you to repent and let me reign and rule in your life. God's calling us to give up that fight and to live that life of humble submission to Him. So I want to invite you to submit to Him. I want to give you, that should be an awe of God from this portion of God's Word. Paul Tripp writes in his book, Dangerous Calling, "Awe of God must dominate my ministry because one of the central missional gifts of the gospel of Jesus Christ is to give people back their awe of God." You see, when you live like you're part of the kingdom of darkness, people just look at you and there's like, I don't see Jesus. I don't see the King of Kings. I don't see the Lord of Lords. I just see somebody who's just like me. But when you live in conformity to the gospel and humble submission to the authority of God's Word, you're displaying the light of the gospel. You're displaying the beauty of Christ. You're displaying the greatness of God. You're giving people their awe of God in your missional kind of humbly submissive manner of life. So let's take a look at Joshua chapter 1, verses 1 to 9 this morning. God is the divine warrior. This theme indicates that there will be a supernatural triumph over land inhabitants. I'm looking primarily at verses 5 and following. "No one will be able to stand up against you all the days of your life. As I was with Moses, so I will be with you. I'll never leave you nor forsake you." This theme indicates this supernatural triumph. The key ideas associated with the divine warrior theme are victory and fight and trust. And when you look at verse 5 is structured to reveal two ideas to us. And you see them here. God terrorizes the enemy and God abides with his people. That's all we need to know. God will terrorize the enemy and he will abide with you. God will go before you. God is going before you. And he's going to abide with you as he walks before you in the course of life. So who is the divine warrior? I think you already know how to answer that question. But let me affirm that for you. Let me affirm the answer to that when you look at the scriptures here. We learn about him in the Exodus 15 Song of Moses. In Exodus chapter 15, verse 3, and you might want to mark this down because this is one of the great Old Testament texts. "The Lord is a man of war. The Lord is his name." Who is the divine warrior? Moses knew it really well. He just saw him at work, parting the Red Sea, bringing the nation of Israel across that dry land, and then allowing that water to engulf the pursuing Egyptians. Who is the divine warrior? It is the Lord, and his name is the Lord. He is a man of war. The Lord God is the great king who will fight for his people. Exodus 14, verse 14, "The Lord will fight for you. You only need to be still." Deuteronomy chapter 1, verse 30, "The Lord your God who is going before you will fight for you as he did in Egypt before your very eyes." And in Joshua chapter 5, verses 13 through 15, he is the captain of the Lord's host. Do you ever wonder who that guy is? You know, as you read through Joshua, those of you who have some working knowledge of the book of Joshua, you come to chapter 5 and you see this warrior standing before Joshua, and Joshua's like, he's like terrified. He's like, "Are you for us or are you against us?" And what does Joshua do? He gets down on his face and he worships the captain of the Lord's host because he recognizes who the divine warrior is. So what does the divine warrior do? God, the divine warrior, assures his leader and terrorizes his enemies. I mean, that's what our God does. Our God is constantly assuring his children of who he is and how he's taking on the enemy for us. God assures and terrorizes. He assures his people. He assures his leader here. He assured his leader, Joshua. The theme of supernatural triumph over the land inhabitants really arises, as I've tried to point out to you already, out of verse 5. That word of divine encouragement. No one will be able to stand up against you. Could you imagine receiving that word as you go into battle? I mean, that would be the most encouraging thing. The Lord is with you. The Lord will not allow anyone to defeat you. The Lord will go before you. The Lord will fight with you. The promise, no one will be able to stand up against you all the days of your life, is usually overlooked in order to explain the promise of divine presence. As I was with Moses, so I'll be with you. I'll never leave you nor forsake you. Probably when you think about Joshua 1:5, I'm sure that you think about that word of promise. I'll never leave you. I'll never forsake you. I will be with you. No doubt you think about that. Probably first. But don't think as much or as deeply about the phrase that goes before it. No one will be able to stand against you. You see, the land inhabitants, along with the physical turf of the promised land, will be given into the hand of Israel. I mean, could you imagine this? Just try to put yourself in the sandals of Joshua at this moment. He's hearing this. He's got a host of Israelite people behind him. And they're worn out and weary from wilderness wanderings. And here they are, ready to enter into the brink. They're on the brink of the promised land. They've been through the Red Sea. They're ready to go in. And Joshua's hearing this. And he is learning that the land inhabitants will have no will to resist Israel and Joshua. He terrorized the enemy. I love how this story reads in the book of Joshua. And I hope that you'll dig into it. But the faint-hearted condition of the Canaanites is an important emphasis in Israel's history. When you look at the scriptures that I've detailed for you here on the side, you can see that the enemy were terrorized time and time and time again by the Lord God who went before his people, taking away, sucking out of them any will, any desire, any determination, any resolve to fight. Take away their will to fight, and we will defeat them. And how did that happen? God did it. He went before his people in order to do this. According to Numbers chapter 14, verse 9, Isaiah chapter 30, verse 2, the Lord promised to remove the shelter or the protection of the land inhabitants. So you see what he's doing? He's taking away their will to fight. They're faint-hearted. They're weary. They're weak. They're not resolved to fight the enemy. And then he's taking away all the protections. So he's not protecting them, and he's not giving them any resolve or any will to fight. He terrorized the enemies in the promised land. The faint-hearted condition of the Canaanites is an important theme here. And it is an outworking of God's promises to the nation. For example, let me show you where it comes out in the text of Joshua. For example, Joshua chapter 2, verse 9. Rahab is a Canaanite who speaks with a Deuteronomy accent, if I could say it that way. She acknowledges that the terror of the Lord has caused the land inhabitants just to melt away. And she talks to the spies. She's like, our people are afraid of you. It's like, how did you hear about us? You know, how did this word get in here? How is this made known that it's terrorizing you? Joshua 2, verse 24, faint-heartedness is noted in the spies' report back to Joshua. Joshua chapter 5, verse 1, the hearts of the people melt. There is no spirit in them. Joshua chapter 9, verse 24. The Gibeonites feared. And so what did they do? They tried to present themselves to Joshua as somebody who are from afar. Why did they do that? Because they were scared to death, and they knew that if they were a people that were part of the immediate territory, they were under the ban of death. And so they wanted to present themselves. Oh, we're from far, far away. We're from far, far away. You know, you need to be at peace with us. And then, of course, in Joshua chapter 10, verse 2, the hill country kings fear. So do you see that? Do you see Joshua 1:5? No one will be able to stand before you. You see how the text, the storyline is written in such a way to bring to your attention as the reader that God's work and God's will that was predetermined, preordained, is being worked out in the lives of the people there? Do you see that? Do you see how God is standing faithful to His Word? Hopefully that will be an encouragement to you. I love this too, because the divine warrior doesn't have the traditional arsenal of weapons. He has supernatural weapons. He has creation at his command. God, the divine warrior, terrorized the enemy and then destroyed them with supernatural weapons. So how did he do that? Well, just start thinking about the storyline of Scripture just for a moment. All right, how did God use supernatural weapons to terrorize and then destroy his enemies? In Exodus, he used the wind and the sea. In Joshua, he used the hailstones of his creation. In Joshua 24, he sent the hornet, as he promised in Exodus 23. In Jonah 1:4, he used a great wind against one of his own. In Kings, he used the heavenly host, and Elijah prayed, "O Lord, open his eyes so he may see." Then the Lord opened the servant's eyes, and he looked, and he saw the hills full of horses and chariots of fire all around Elisha. Do you see that? Do you see the weaponry? Do you see the arsenal? I'll never forget when I was living in Virginia Beach, Virginia, and back in the day before 9/11, and when access to the military bases was much more easy to get in and out. There were a couple of Navy SEALs who were in our church. One in particular we got to know. It was kind of interesting to think about a Navy SEAL who was a trained killer working with middle school students at Colonial Baptist Church, but that's the reality of it. I guess you have to be trained to that level. But anyway, we got a tour of the Navy SEAL base. How many of you want to be SEALs? Any guys here want to be a SEAL or a Ranger? I mean, it is incredible. It is incredible. So we go through all of the different parts of military life for a Navy SEAL. We go to the swimming area. We go to the parachute area. We go to what else did we do? We went to the arsenal. And here we are. I mean, this is pre-9/11. But we walk into this room, and it's just filled with weaponry. You know, guns of all kinds, ammunition of all sorts. And our daughter Allison is just holding a machine gun at the time. We get to take a picture of her, you know, in that regard. We'll have to find that picture and sometime show it to you. But you think about the weaponry that is at the command of our military, our Navy SEALs, and how they are trained for sophisticated warfare and almost present themselves as invincible. And it just really pales. It really pales when you think about the weaponry of our great God as the divine warrior who marshals creation in just the whisper of his voice. He whistles and the hornets come. You see, he is in control of his creation, using it for his honor and for his glory. He fought for Israel throughout the history, her history, and will continue to fight for his people, including you and me. He's still on active duty. He hasn't retired. He's not out of commission. He's not a has-been who's had several volumes written about him. So despite what many critics may think even about the absence of the Lord from the book of Esther, the Lord, the divine warrior, fingerprint is all over the book of Esther. Some would like to say Esther should not be in the canon of Scripture. It is devoid of God. But when you read Esther in light of Joshua, you see the fingerprint of the divine warrior all over it. The language of Esther, the battle counts that you find in there uncover the presence of the Lord and emphasize his unshakable commitment to his people. So what do you think? What are you thinking about this as you sit here and you listen to me? How does this theme instruct you? How does this theme warn you? How does this theme impart hope to you? You see, that's what Paul told us in the New Testament this story is supposed to do with us and do to us. So we're just going through Joshua chapter 1, verses 1 through 9 for some intellectual exercise. We're going through it looking for instruction and warning and hope. Can you derive anything this morning from this text so far that would do one of these three things for you? What is the good news? What's the gospel of Joshua at this point? Well, the supernatural triumph of the divine warrior defines the character and the work of God in royal and military and redemptive ways. If nothing else, friends, if nothing else, see your God in this way. See Him in a multidimensional, high-definition, biblically robust manner. See Him this way. See Him as the King of Kings. See Him as the Lamb of God. See Him as the divine warrior. This theme highlights the fiery commitment of the Lord to His promises and thus gives us hope. The Lord will fight for me. I want you to go out of here today knowing the Lord is committed to you, His children. That's what the Bible says. Period. All right? Maybe you're here this morning and you're just like, man, I don't know. Where's God in my life? I don't see it. I don't feel it. I don't know it. I don't understand it. I want you to go out today and know that God, the divine warrior, is committed to His children. And if you are His child, by faith in Jesus Christ, He's committed to you. You've got to know that. That is a significant piece. That's a significant boulder in your worldview. If you don't grab that and see that and understand that, you're just going to move all around, up and down, all over the place. There will never, ever be any lasting peace or joy in your life. This theme just resounds the righteousness and the holiness of God. Warns me not to fight against the Lord with my rebellious actions or attitudes. Yes, the Lord will fight against His people. If you are going to be rebellious against the divine warrior, and hear me in this, if you are going to live a rebellious life in your actions or your attitudes, God will not let that go. He'll fight against that. And He will bring you down to submission. Joshua 1, 5 to 9, God the divine warrior abides with His people. The exhortations to be strong and courageous, to not tremble, and to not be dismayed in 1, 6, 7, and 9 are based on the promise of the Lord's presence and His faithful commitment to His covenant people. Do you see, assurance is rooted in the character and the Word of God. You know, I just tried to accentuate as loudly and as passionately as I could with you the commitment of God to you. And I'm doing that based upon what the Scriptures tell me who God is and what He does. And so I want you to see that your assurance is not just something Clem says to you. Because who is Clem? Clem is nothing. But your assurance and your confidence is rooted in the Word of God and the character of God. When you look at this text, structurally, the exhortations to be strong, to be courageous, are bracketed by the promises of God to be with you. I just love form. Look at the form of Joshua 1, 5 through 9. I'll be with you. I'll not leave you or forsake you. Then you step in two verses. Be strong and of good courage. This people shall divide the land. Only be strong and very courageous, for the Lord your God is with you wherever you go. Do you see that? 1, 5 and 1, 9. They're the outer brackets. That's like the fence. And inside the fence is simply this. Be strong and be of courage, that you may observe to do all the law. I'm with you. As you see here, the presence of God with His people is a basic premise of Israelite faith. The God of Israel accomplishes, or He accompanies, He leads, He protects, He fights, He goes before His people. And of course, this is affirmed in the conquest, and we won't take time to look through all of that, but as you read the book of Joshua, you can see these affirmations. The presence of God with His people is a basic premise of our faith. This is gospel news. Hebrews chapter 13, verse 5, keep your lives free from the love of money and be content with what you have, because God has said, never will I leave you, never will I forsake you. How about Matthew 28, verses 19 to 20? You've heard that probably a million times in the course of your Christian life. But look at what it says there in verse 20. And teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you, and surely I am with you always to the very end of the age. Since God will win the victory for His faithful people, He calls upon them to trust His word, and to trust His word of promise. He fights for His people. He fights against His disobedient people. He fights against their sin and their unrighteousness. And then again in Revelation chapter 2, verse 16, He calls us to repentance. See, that's why I started with that as a goal. I want to call you to repentance. Are you fighting against the Lord in your actions or your attitudes? Would you see the greatness of your God as the divine warrior? Would you understand that you're never going to win? Give up the fight. Give up the fight. So in what way can we appropriately apply this theme to your life and my life as New Testament believers? How do we get to Jesus from here? What's the gospel good news? What's the gospel benefit of this text? Well, the divine warrior good news is simply this. Jesus Christ is a divine warrior. Hear it loud. Hear it clear. Grab it and be assured of it. He is the mighty one who has done great things. Luke 1. He is the one transfigured like the divine warrior on the high mountain. He is the one who defeated the principalities and powers. He is the one who defeated death. He is the one who will never leave you nor forsake you. He is the victorious Lamb of God. Jesus is the divine warrior, doing all of these things in perfection. In perfections. And now we have already talked about Revelation 17, so we won't belabor that. But what's the gospel living benefit of this text for you and for me this morning? Jesus, our divine warrior, is the God of conquest for every battle of your life. What's the battle you're in right now? He is the God of conquest for that battle of your life right now. In the race of life, Paul tells us in 1 Corinthians 9:26, we can run with certainty. We know we're not beating the air. The divine warrior is the one who enables you to fight the good fight of faith. You're able to wage a good warfare. You're able to fight a good fight of faith. You will lay hold of eternal life. Jesus, our divine warrior, is the God of conquest who battled for your soul. Don't ever forget that. I mean, if you just think about it, even from that dimension of life, Jesus is the divine warrior who battled for my soul. Ephesians chapter 2, verses 1 to 10 tells us the "but God" of Ephesians 2, 4 is pivotal in that text. Jesus, our divine warrior, delivered us from the prince of the power of this air. He is the God of grace. He is active on duty. He is our redeemer. He is our deliverer. He's the one loving us, fighting for us, and accepting us. And he's the one who's calling on us to love and trust him. Oh, man, I love this text. I don't know. I love the text. I love the emphasis. I love the theology of it. And I just hope that you'll spend some time with it and enjoy it. I hope that this kind of thing, this kind of teaching, this kind of theology, this kind of biblical content will bolster your faith and confidence in the eternal God of heaven and earth. I hope that as you leave this room this morning, maybe you came into this room through those doors with just lots of burdens, lots of cares, lots of concerns, lots of pressures, lots of unanswered questions. I hope you'll go out with some measure of confidence that Jesus, divine warrior, is going before you and will fight for you. Let's stand together and be dismissed in a word of prayer.